In this screencast, we'll work through a piping example to determine the losses associated with the pipe network and flow characteristics so that we could determine the pressure drop between two points. For instance, the difference between the pressure entering a house, we'll call point one, and that leaving a faucet, we'll call point two. So let's look at this problem setup, in which we have water flowing from our city supply network into our house and up to a second floor bathroom out of a faucet. The goal in this problem is going to be to determine the pressure drop between points 1 and 2. Now, the first thing I like to do is to convert all the values we're given to the same unit system and collect any information we may need to help us along the way, like properties of the fluid. So we have water coming in from our city line, which if you do a quick Google search, maybe let's assume 60 degrees Fahrenheit for the system, we will need the density and viscosity of the water at 60 degrees Fahrenheit, and we're working in English units. So you can look this up in a table, in a book, or an online reference, and you should get the following properties. I think we have everything we need in the units we need. If we need to convert anything else, we could do it at that time. So now we need to determine the losses associated with this system. And we know in determining losses, the velocity of the fluid plays a large role. Furthermore, we need to determine whether the flow is laminar or turbulent, since that's going to tell us how to determine the major frictional losses in the pipe system. So let's start with determining the type of flow. Now, to determine the type of flow, whether it's laminar or turbulent, we could use the dimensionless Reynolds number. And the Reynolds number is represented by the density of the fluid times the velocity of the fluid times the diameter over the viscosity. We have the density, the diameter, and the viscosity, but we haven't calculated the velocity. And we know we could convert the volumetric flow rate to a velocity using the cross-sectional area of the pipe. So when we do that, and I get a velocity equal to 4.08 feet per second. So now we could calculate our Reynolds number. And when we plug in all these values, you'll see that the units don't directly cancel out. And that's because we have not written in our unit conversion for slug, which is 1 pound is equal to 1 slug times 1 foot per second squared. And when we do that and convert for the slug to pound, you'll see that this is indeed dimensionless. And you'll also see that our value is 2.8 times 10 to the fourth, which is clearly turbulent flow. Now, when we do these types of problems, we're going to approach them using an overall energy balance between the two points. And recall from our problem setup, our two points are the inlet and the outlet. So this is what our overall energy balance looks like. Now, we don't have any shaft work for our system, so I haven't even written it in there. But we do account for the pressure terms, which is P1 and P2. We account for the kinetic energy term at point 1 and point 2. We count for the potential energy terms at point 1 and point 2. And then we have to account for our losses. And I've written out our losses as two different terms. Our major loss term, which has to do with the frictional losses in the pipe, and our minor loss term, which has to do with all the joints and connections between the pipes. So this almost becomes a plug and chug type of problem at this point, but we have to make sure to use the units appropriately, and we need to make sure we're using the correct values. And it may not be familiar on how to calculate our frictional factor, F, or this KL term, which is our minor loss coefficient for the minor losses. So we're in the problem statement looking for P1 minus P2. Alpha 1 and alpha 2, we can assume is going to be unity. Since this is turbulent flow, the velocity profiles are nearly uniform across the pipe, and they're the same at the two points. So alpha is equal to 1. Now density we had is 1.94 slugs per foot cubed. Our velocity at point 1, we already calculated, was 4.08 feet per second. So that takes care of this term. Now for our second term, we have rho g z1. Now since point 1 is the lowest point in our system, we could use this as our starting point and consider our elevation at this point to be equal to 0 feet. So this term just drops out. So we're looking for P1 minus P2. We have our next term set up to solve. We said alpha 2 is equal to 1. We don't know the velocity at point 2, so that's something we need to determine. So we use the same method we did before, the volumetric flow rate divided by the cross-sectional area at point 2. And this cross-sectional area, if you recall, had a pipe diameter of 3/4 of an inch. So solving this gives us an exit velocity of 7.26 feet per second. So now we know everything to calculate that term. For our next term, rho gz2, we have our density. For gravity, we're going to use 32.174 feet per second squared. And then we need to know what our z2 is. So the elevation at point 2 is just the height at point 2 relative to our elevation 0 at point 1. So you can see that we have 5 feet high here, 10 feet high there. So a height of 15 feet. And now we know everything we need to for that term. So we're finally left with our major and minor loss term. Now, unfortunately, this one's not quite as straightforward. To determine the major loss, we have to figure out what the frictional factor F is. And one way to do this is to use the Moody diagram. Now, there's a screencast on using Moody diagrams, so you can check that out to get an idea on how to use it appropriately. I'm going to pull it up here and just show you how I'm going to find it. Now, this is the Moody diagram, which could tell us what the frictional factor F is based on the relative roughness of the pipe and the Reynolds number. We have the Reynolds number, which we calculated as 2.8 times 10 to the fourth, which is roughly about right in here. Now, the relative roughness is determined by the roughness of the pipe as well as the diameter of the pipe. So our roughness factor for our copper pipe can be looked up in a table and found to be 5 times 10 to the minus 6 feet. Our diameter, we already converted into feet as 0.0833 feet. This gives us a relative roughness factor of 6 times 10 to the minus 5, which falls right above this line of 5 times 10 to the minus 5. So if we follow those up until they intersect, we get a frictional factor of about 0.024. You could also use the Kohlberg equation to analytically solve for the frictional factor. So continuing to determine our values, our length is just the combined length of all of the pipes. So let's go back to our diagram. We have 10 feet plus 5 plus 5 plus 10 plus 10 plus 5, which gives us 45 feet. Lastly, our diameter of our pipe, which now means we could solve for this term. However, it's not clear what velocity we use here. Now, we want to use the velocity through the pipe, so that is V1 that we calculated before. So now we have everything needed to determine our major frictional losses in our piping system. We can move on to our last term, our minor losses. Now, for the minor loss term, we need to determine the loss coefficients for each connection and designated component, like the contraction bin at the faucet. So we look these up. So for each 90-degree bend, which we have one here, one here, one there, one there. We don't count the one at the faucet because we're given the loss coefficient for that faucet. So we have 4 times the loss coefficient of a 90-degree bend. So we can look this up in a table, and we find that this loss coefficient for a 90-degree bend that's for threaded components, as it says here, is equal to 1.5. So we have 4 times 1.5, which gives us a value of 6. So this accounts for the losses through each of the bends. Now we also have an open globe valve. So we look this up in the table. And for open globe valves, we will find that the KL is equal to 10. The last thing we could see in this problem is that there is a KL at the faucet. And this KL is given to us as 2.5. So the sum of our KL terms, which gives us 18.5. And again, we have our density and our velocity through the piping system of 4.08. So now we have everything to determine the minor loss term. So at this point, it really is just plug and chug. And this is what the final equation should look like. Now, I haven't included any of the units in any of this, but I've double-checked to make sure that they all do cancel out and I have the right form. And when I add all this up correctly, I get a pressure drop equal to negative 1,480, which seems incredibly high. Except do recall that because of our units, we're working in pounds per foot squared. So this actually, when converted, is 10.3 psi, or pounds per square inch, which is a much more reasonable value when talking about the pressure loss through a piping system, such as the one in the problem statement. Now, whether it's negative or positive doesn't really matter as long as we understand that it's a pressure drop and that the pressure is higher at the inlet than it is at the outlet. Now, if we wanted to calculate what P1 was, we would just need to know P2, which in this case is just exiting the atmosphere. So P2 is equal to zero, which means that our inlet pressure for our system is also 10.3 psi. So hopefully this gives you an idea on how to calculate the pressure drop given certain components of our piping system in the flow characteristics. In another screencast, we'll use a very similar problem to determine the flow rate if that was our unknown.